just heard a few verses from the Lithuanian composer Feliksas Majoris. This song, Eik Sesu Pagarjani, or Go Sister to the Garden, was one of his first compositions, written in 1959. The same year he started his composition studies in Vilnius, Lithuania. Much of his work reflects Lithuanian tradition, which will be explored in this hour's presentation. The song Eik Sesu Pagarjani is based on the Lithuanian traditional genre of wedding songs. That genre contains multitudes of subgenres, but in this case, the story is fairly straightforward and familiar. Young love triumphs, even in the face of financial difficulty. Before jumping into the composer's style and career, I think it's important to understand Lithuania and its musical climate during the 20th century. While Bajoris' music holds plenty of intrigue on its own, the events leading up to 1959 and through his early career color many of his creative choices. Lithuania's history is long, but the events happening in the late 19th and early 20th centuries had the most profound impact on musical expression by the mid-20th century. For many years, Lithuania was part of the Russian Empire. The local culture was competing with Russian, Polish, and German influence. The archaic language and traditional customs of Lithuania were being expunged from society. In the late 1800s, printing and even teaching Lithuanian was illegal. However, as nationalism became more popular in the 1800s, Lithuania also experienced a surge of national sentiment. Due to the efforts of rural communities, often led by the churches of the area, folk songs were preserved and with them the language. Lithuanian composers, for once reaching international recognition, often used folk material as sources of inspiration. One such composer was M.K. Čiurlionis, who lived from 1875 to 1911, and who is considered a primary nationalist figure. After World War I, Lithuania saw a brief period of independence until the start of World War II, during which Lithuania was occupied by the Germans. Afterwards, the country was annexed into the Soviet Union in 1945. When the Soviet Union took control of Lithuania and many other regions, one of the ways their control was asserted was through socialist realism. This policy used arts and culture as propaganda for the USSR. Progressive stances and art forms were often censored and repressed, and even native traditions, when allowed, were used to uphold the Soviet Union. In Lithuania, even folk music was initially banned due to its association with local armed resistance. Beyond social control, one of the major goals of socialist realism was to be accessible to the masses, so setting folk tunes to concert music became a thing. By the 1950s, folk music was integrated into classical popular music. These arrangements were still censored, so that individualism in progressive music was discouraged. This brings us back to Feliksas Majoris. Again, he started studying composition in 1959, the same year Eik Sesu Pagarjani and this next piece Ash Floreo Rolojeli, were written. Translated as I Did Have a Brother, Ash Floreo Rolojeli embodies the spirit of adventure, featuring a rambunctious young boy, his horse, and the beauty of nature. Both 1959 pieces feature Lithuanian folk texts heavy with nature elements. References to nature are common in folk literature, as the Lithuanian tradition is heavily influenced by rural communities. Family ties are also common, so the subject in this next song, A Little Brother, is expected. Musically, these two songs are united by orchestration. The vocal lines are simple, and the song forms are strophic, featuring many repetitions, even within verses. beginning of his career. Additionally, as seen in the previous selections, this song also contains familial imagery, lending more Lithuanian authenticity to the work. Here the speaker mourns the loss of a family, comparing that loss to the emptiness of a forest without birds.
Just miss us, but I know. Time is
well-respected example of Lithuanian music from the 20th century. This song cycle is based on a collection of fairy tales written by Jonas Vallius. Bajoras first found this collection of stories as a boy in his violin teacher's house. The narratives chosen for the song cycle are all self-contained and easily adapted for music. In this song cycle, it's easiest to find the loop structure that Bajoras associates with modernism. As seen in this diagram, the song cycle begins with a prelude and ends with a postlude. Between these bookends, there are three sections, each with three songs. The number three is significant to Lithuanian folklore, often portrayed as a magic number, so its inclusion is fitting. Each section corresponds to an overarching theme, namely God and earth, trees and humans, and devils and humans. The section themes are also of interest as they go against socialist realism ideals. In the Soviet Union, anything religious or lore-related was discouraged. These thematic choices obviously conflict with that ideology. While Bajoras' thematic choices do not appear to stem from any personal beliefs, they can certainly be seen as a response to censorship. For today's program, I will sing the middle section of the Sapu Suika, which is about humans and trees. This section is considered to be the most lyrical from the entire work, but it also is strongly narrative-driven. It has also been described as the musical climax or the high point within the song cycle. In the first song, translated to "Why do trees not speak?" the song is lament-like, mourning the ancient times when trees had a voice. As if conjuring images of times long ago, the piano line is filled with broken chords, meant to indicate an archaic stringed instrument plucked in accompaniment. In the second song, translated as "The Blind Ash," the song features dialogue, which is unusual for narrative songs, and a strong pulse element in both the vocal and piano lines. The texture of this song is polyphonic, which likely pulls from the sutartina genre native to northern Lithuania. A sutartina is a genre of Lithuanian folk music that features at least two voices in canon. The lines aren't just imitative, but sometimes an exact copy of one another. Because the lines of the genre are offset, dissonant intervals of a second, a tritone, and a seventh are common. Additionally, the singing range of these songs is narrow and often less than one octave. Looking at the blind ash, many of the characteristics of the sutartina are found in a reinterpretation. Dramatically speaking, the imitative lines bring a sense of dialogue, which is fitting in the song's narrative. The blind ash tree calls out to others, asking if it's time to grow or drop leaves according to the seasons. The other trees in the forest mockingly reply with misinformation to humiliate the ash tree. Finally, the third song, "O Oak Tree," features the strong symbol of the oak, often associated with Lithuania. Here the speaker urgently calls to the oak tree to live and grow in the meadows, not to be chopped down. The piano line, particularly at the end, paints a strong picture of an axe-wielding foe. In this song in particular, the message can be read as pro-Lithuanian. As mentioned previously, Bajoras' trademarks are a metrical pulse, aleatoric figures, and modernist tendencies, all of which are exhibited in the section of Sapu Suika. What is noteworthy about these characteristics is that they are used to amplify the drama and the native components. The pulse keeps the vocal and piano lines together through the polyphonic sections, as well as creating word painting at the end of the final song. Aleatoric sections often signify worry or fear, and the heavy dissonance within the songs fit both the modern and native soundscapes.
Thank you.
singing melodies, with modern harmonizations to elevate the work into modern art. For Villoldas, Shunak Sally represents the advancement in his compositional style. Russia. The speaker describes racing away from the storm in carriages, three fish and three sisters. While the number three is again a significant number in folklore, here the image references the three Baltic states, Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia. While the first song asks why, the last song features a child secure in the knowledge that safety is found in a mother's hands. Despite the ominous warnings heard in the piano line, the child happily sings about swallows and butterflies, safe from the cold north wind. Perhaps this child knows best, but to the adult, the cold north wind, implying the Soviet Union, is hard to ignore. Due to the political climate of the 1970s, the symbolism included in these songs clearly stood for pro-Lithuanian sentiment. In addition to the imagery and double meanings incorporated into the word, Bjork still weaves in his signature compositional techniques of a pulse to navigate the mixed meters, heavy dissonance, and a flair for drum, as indicated by spoken inflection.
Quod est patus culmis, quis placiat? At this point, let's take a few minutes break so everyone can congratulate Hannah, and then Parks and Rec?
Yeah.
Okay, she'll be done this day. Unless anyone has any public questions, right? Sounds like everyone.